you seen my childhood? I'm searching for the world that I come from, 'cause I've been looking around in the lost and found of my heart.
HBO decided to put out a documentary about the late Michael Jackson, the King of Pop. Now, this documentary isn't celebrating his life, showing things about Michael Jackson maybe his fans did not know. No, this documentary, Leaving Neverland, is one of the most evil, lying, treacherous things that HBO could put out about Michael Jackson. Now, they bring out some boys who were discredited, no proof of anything back when Michael Jackson was alive. Now they're saying that repeatedly they were molested by Michael Jackson after the man is dead and gone and the man cannot defend himself. See, even when a black man is dead, they try to smear you and ruin your legacy. Now.
Yeah, you know, there's been different times where it just be me and Michael. Then there'll be other times where he has other friends over too. That's what, like what Brett said, it's just a slumber party. We just have a lot of fun.
And you know, I've slept in the same bed as Michael. It's just you watch cartoons, you fall asleep. You know, it's just a friendship. And I know he would never do anything to hurt my brother. He's the nicest guy you've ever met.
Right, so at 9 years old, things are starting to happen for you?
Yeah, we moved to America and Michael helped me out in the beginning, put me in a couple of his videos. And that helped me get like a dance agent and that sort of thing. And so I would start dancing in other people's videos and then got a theatrical agent, started doing commercials and like guest episodes in Full House and shows like that. And when I was, I think, 11, I got in a rap group, a rap duo, me and this other kid. And we ended up being signed to Sony Records. And did an album there. And that's what sort of got me interested in music production. One of the best things I ever had was my teachers, actually, which was my mother, my grandmother, and Michael. And the things that they taught me was, if there was anything that I wanted, they taught me how to visualize. I think the most important thing for kids is to really figure out what they want, realize that anything is possible. So don't hold back in your dreams. Always shoot as high as you possibly can, but be detailed about it.
And you started as a youngster dancing with Michael Jackson?
Yeah.
Going to the ranch. No. Are you still friendly with Michael?
Yeah, we still talk every couple months, catch up.
You do, know? Really? Yeah. What's he like?
What's he like? He's a good guy.
He's a good guy?
Yeah.
Show me where he touched you.
Nothing ever like that, no nonsense, no shenanigans.
No.
But it's like, you know, as long as people don't forget, you know, how talented he is and what he's done for the music industry. Think whatever you want about him, but you can't deny his talent.
What's the most misunderstood thing about Michael Jackson, do you think, that you know him?
Probably a number of things.
That I don't know, that anybody that lives that life is not going to be your average dude. You know what I mean? In the simple ways, I mean,
yeah.
You know, you live that kind of life and that sort of fame from 5 years old, you're not going to go about your everyday like everybody else because you've never lived a life like everybody else. So how would you know how to do that?
Exactly.
So, and I think people take those simple things and turn them into something, you know, 10 times, 100 times more strange than they are.
One of the things I noticed about you, and this goes back to why I said you were a stand-up guy, we covered the trial, and you were one of the few people to stick up for him.
Mm-hmm.
And why do you think that was, and why was it important for you to stick up for him?
Because he's always been a friend of me. That's what you do for friends, you tell the truth. You know? I can't speak for him, but it would be an absolutely painful thing for anybody to go through. And then there's obviously such a huge connection between Michael Jackson and MTV and really starting this real music video generation on MTV. I mean, Michael was really the king of that. So I like all of those connections. And obviously my connection with Michael and all of that coming together is kind of just one of those serendipitous things where all the elements have come together. So I'm excited for a lot of reasons to be a part of this. In general, with Michael, just had a wonderful relationship. I learned so much from him as an artist and as a kind human being. And it's my goal to try and just continue as much as I can in my own little world. He talks so much about him as the pop legend, which is important, but it's nice to really remember that he was a man, that he was a father, and that's what it's really about, is a father and his children, and he's a wonderful dad, and you know, at least they had the time with him that they did.
I'm starting on Cirque du Soleil Michael Jackson show. So it's, you know, the equivalent of the Beatles Love show that they have, or the Elvis show, but for Michael, which is, you know, exciting and terrifying all at the same time, because it's such a huge responsibility. But that was why I took it on. You know, Michael was such a huge part of my career and life. We were friends for 20 years before he passed, since I was 7. So it's an opportunity for me to give back a little bit to his legacy. It's such a big part of his legacy, and to make sure as much as I can that it's done right and that it really represents his essence.
I never forgot one moment of what Michael did to me, but I was psychologically and emotionally completely unable and unwilling to understand that it was sexual abuse.
So what are you alleging that he actually did?
He sexually abused me from 7 years old until 14.
I know it's a difficult and personal question, but can you be more specific? Because you're accusing someone who is deceased of criminal activity.
Yeah.
So I need you to be a little more specific. Did he perform sexual acts on you? Did he force you to perform sexual acts on him? What was the nature of the abuse?
Yes. Exactly what you said. He performed sexual acts on me and forced me to perform sexual acts on him.
When you testified in 2005, mm-hmm. and you took the stand and you raised your right hand and you swore under oath that nothing sexual ever happened between you and Michael Jackson,
yeah.
why did you lie?
You know, I said what I understood and I said what I was able to say. From 7 years old, from day one of the abuse, Michael told me that we loved each other and that this was love, that this was an expression of our love. And then you'd follow that up with, you know, but if you ever tell anyone what we're doing, both of our lives and our careers will be over. When I was 11, when the first trial was going on, the criminal investigation in 93, mm-hmm. He would call me every day and role play and tell me the same sort of things, and also tell me then that if anyone ever thought that we did these things, any of these sexual things, that both of us would go to jail. There was no money, there was no, you must lie. Michael, when he would talk to me before these things were going on, and he would call me every day as these things were happening, it was complete manipulation and brainwashing. It wasn't any sense of the truth on the phone. He would role play with me and train me for these scenarios.
Listen, when I say his name to you this morning, what do you think of?
Heartbreak, pain, anger, and compassion. There's no excuse for what he did to me, and I believe many others, but he was a troubled man, and every effect has its cause. You know, the image that one presents to the world is not the whole explanation of who someone is. You know, Michael Jackson was, yes, an incredibly talented artist, and with an incredible gift. He was many things, and he was also a pedophile and a child sexual abuser.
I remember when the FBI was investigating Michael Jackson, all he had, his court cases. I remember all of that. Now, Michael Jackson may not be here to defend himself, but there was some footage that I found. We even posted it to our Twitter page as well. Well, Michael Jackson's going to tell you exactly when all the negativity and accusations about him came out. But I want you to listen to this 2-minute clip from Michael Jackson.
I broke Elvis' records. I broke Beatles' records. The minute it became the all-time best-selling album in the history of the Guinness Book of World Records, overnight, they called me a freak. They called me a homosexual. They called me a child molester. They said I tried to bleach my skin. They made everything to turn the public against me. This was all complete, complete conspiracy. You have to know that. I know my race. I just look in the mirror. I know I'm black. They manipulate our history books. The history books are not true. It's a lie. The history books are lying. You need to know that. You must know that. All the forms of popular music, from jazz to hip hop to bebop to soul, you know, to you talk about the different dances, from the cakewalk to the jitterbug to the Charleston to break dancing. All these are forms of black dancing. These things are very important. But if you go to the bookstore down the corner, you won't see one black person on the cover. You'll see Elvis Presley. You'll see the Rolling Stones. But where are the real pioneers who started? Otis Blackwell was a prolific, phenomenal writer. He wrote some of the greatest Elvis Presley songs ever. And this was a black man.
So you heard it from Michael himself. When he outsold Elvis, he outsold the Beatles. When he made the Guinness Book of World Records, then they start saying that he was a freak and he's a homosexual and that he's a child molester. And that sounds about right. And did you hear Michael? He said he looked in the mirror, he see a black man, he's black. He had no problem telling people he was black. Michael was definitely within his blackness. I know Michael had his own issues. Who don't have their own issues? But Michael loves to be a black man. I remember when they had even asked Michael Jackson that, who would you like to play you in a movie if somebody portrayed you? Would it be somebody black or white? He said, black. He said, I'm black. Like, Michael had no problem saying that. Well, Michael Jackson was not only a great entertainer, but Michael Jackson was a smart businessman. They were so pissed off when he bought the Beatles catalog. They hated that. You know, no artist is supposed to be that smart to get the Beatles catalog. He had owned half of Sony's publishing. So anything that Sony was doing while he was alive, Michael was getting checks. Michael didn't have to come out with no more records if he didn't want to. I mean, Michael owned a lot of things. He didn't go blow his money. And the thing is, they hate when a black man outsmart them in their own game. Can't stand that. And they killed Michael Jackson. Come on. Conrad Murray. Look at the amount of time that he did for that with Michael Jackson. Just pay attention to it. You know, a black man barely has some weed in his pocket and get more time than that. So it's all connected. And you seen the moment that Michael died, all this stuff started happening with his estate. Same thing with Prince. You know, Prince got all his masters back, and all of a sudden Prince died mysteriously. Oda gave Prince the wrong medication. Same thing, how they killed both of them, Prince and Michael Jackson. But this situation with Michael is just completely sick. And HBO, like I said, you're wrong for that, because you have no evidence of anything other than their words. See, we're in this Me Too era, and that you can come out and just say something about somebody and automatically it's supposed to be believed with no evidence at all.
The idea that I would make all of this up and put myself, my wife, my son, my entire family through this, you know, extremely stressful and painful experience, all for the sake of money, is completely
incomprehensible. But that's what you're going to be accused of. You're going to be accused. Absolutely. You're going to say you defended Michael Jackson while he was alive because he was good for your career. Mm-hmm. And now that he's gone, there's an opportunity here to sue his estate. He can't defend him.
Thank you. Wade Robson was interviewed by Matt Lauer in 2013. Robson stated during this interview that he did not have a financial motive for making accusations against Michael, and the mere idea of doing so was incomprehensible to him. But evidence suggests otherwise. In December 2010, Wade was offered to direct the dance movie Step Up 4, which eventually came out under the title Step Up Revolution. According to court papers and a blog post Robson wrote on November 17, 2017, Robson considered the directing opportunity a fulfillment of Michael Jackson's prophecy to him as a child that he would become a movie director of epic proportions, even bigger than Steven Spielberg. Robson was so seriously impacted by the alleged prophecy that he crumbled under the pressure of the assignment. Robson may have had two realizations. One, a Step Up movie was too big a venture for him to manage, and two, he was not going to be the next Spielberg. The standard demands of the industry proved too much for Robson, triggered a nervous breakdown which eventually forced him to withdraw from the project. Wade wrote in his blog post from 2017,
"Additionally, I was now ravaged by a debilitating feeling of shame that I was a complete failure. I felt that my entire life had been building to this opportunity to become a film director. It had arrived. I was fulfilling Michael's prophecy, and then I blew it. Therefore, my entire life, I believed, had been in vain. Thank God I had Amanda and our baby boy, because beyond that, I felt no purpose anymore."
Although Wade does not mention it in any of the court papers or his blog post, the Step Up project was not his first failed attempt at directing a movie. In an interview that he gave Dance Informer in April 2009, Robson revealed that he and his wife Amanda were working on their first feature film at the time. When asked why he declined to direct Britney Spears' 2009 tour, Wade said that it was because their priority was creating a movie. Robson is quoted as saying,
"We've been writing the film all through 2008 as well, but Amanda was mostly working on it because I was doing the Cirque show. So it was kind of really broken and hard to really focus on it.
And
we were supposed to do this Britney tour, but it was just another distraction, and we really want to move into film and really make this the next path for us. I spend most of my time saying no to jobs, probably to my own demise."
The Cirque show he mentioned here is not to be mistaken for the Cirque du Soleil show featuring Michael Jackson. It is the Criss Angel Believe show in which Robson worked as the choreographer. Criss Angel Believe was both a critical and a commercial failure, eventually cancelled in 2016. Robson also revealed in the same interview that he and Amanda were writing a theatre show as well. Neither a movie nor the theatre show materialised, despite both Wade and Amanda putting in a lot of time and effort into their work, sacrificing other projects. Under the pressure, Robson suffered an emotional collapse, eventually seeking professional help. On May 16, 2011, he started cognitive therapy for about a month. Evidence shows that on May 21st, 2011, only 5 days after he started therapy, Robson wrote an email to the director of the Cirque du Soleil show in which he stated,
"I always wanted to do the SMJ show, badly."
In the same email about his failed attempt at directing the Step Up movie, he wrote,
"Look, the directing gig didn't work out. It was consuming me in an unhealthy way that I wasn't okay with, being a brand new father. Maybe it just wasn't the right time. Maybe I just wasn't ready to direct a studio film."
Robson was hired for the Cirque du Soleil show, but it was decided that Jamie King was better qualified to direct, and Robson was assigned for a lower position. So business for Robson was not doing well. In his pursuit as a filmmaker, Robson declined career offers with guaranteed earnings burning his professional connections and bridges. He exhausted his savings and assets. Robson had not done anything mention worthy for almost a decade, and he blamed Michael Jackson because Jackson had told him he would become big. In March 2012, about a year after his first breakdown, Robson suffered a second nervous breakdown. He went to a new therapist in April 2012, where he started an insight-orientated therapy. According to his story, about 3 weeks into therapy, on May 8, 2012, Robson declared the first allegations of his sexual abuse by Michael Jackson to his therapist. Robson suddenly, conveniently, remembered or accepted the alleged abuse, and he had been shopping for a book deal, as revealed by his own emails from late 2012 and early 2013. Specifically, with the help of his long-term entertainment lawyer, Helen Yu, several book publishers were contacted, but apparently he was turned down by all of them. In a privilege log provided during discovery, we can see that 73 emails were sent between Wade, literary agent Alan Nevins, and Helen Yu in the period between December 12, 2012 and February 22, 2013. The fact that Robson has a financial interest in accusing and suing the Michael Jackson estate is also highlighted by Robson's legal actions. Robson filed two types of legal action against Jackson's entities, perjuring himself to get around the statute of limitations. He filed a creditor's claim against the estate in probate court and a lawsuit against two of Jackson's companies in civil court for the alleged childhood sexual abuse, arguing that due to his alleged sexual abuse, he would never be able to work in entertainment again. Therefore, he needs financial compensation. Robson demanded a whopping $1.62 billion and still kept working in the entertainment business, having done various insignificant projects since. Looking at Safechuck's allegation, he's never got as far in the court system as Robson's, so there are no depositions regarding him. What we do have is his complaint and his declaration. Represented by the same lawyers as Robson, Safechuck ended up with an eerily similar explanation. Like Robson, Safechuck too claims that up until shortly before he filed his lawsuit, he did not realise that he had allegedly been sexually abused as a child.
I never knew that what he did to me was sexual abuse. I continued into adulthood not understanding that what he did and what we did together was wrong.
It seems very convenient that we have two adult men that realized only until shortly before filing their lawsuits that sexual relations between an underage boy and a grown man are wrong and considered child abuse. Safechuck claims that what triggered his realization of abuse was the birth of his son in 2010 and worrying about having pedophilic urges about him. Safechuck is quoted as saying,
I got married and had a son. I continued to live in denial and secrecy. After my son was born in late 2010, my fear of exposure became worse as I realized that now other people were part of my life and I was dragging them into it. I began to see how innocent children really are and to worry that I would have pedophilic urges.
Let's compare this to what Robson claimed about his realization process in his declaration.
In March 2012, I had my second and final nervous breakdown, which again included feelings of extreme stress, anxiety, fear, and depression. I would look at my son and imagine him experiencing the sexual acts I did with no one, which I did not yet equate with being sexually abused. And, for the first time in my life, I wondered if I needed to talk to someone about what Doan and I did together. I knew that I truly had no idea how I felt about it.
If this story makes you a little uncomfortable, trust me, you're not alone. In a blog post on November 24, 2017, Robson wrote this about when he first told his allegations to his wife.
I believe it was that night or the next morning at the latest that Amanda asked me one of the heaviest questions I've ever received. I am sorry, but I have to ask you this, she said. Do you have any confusion about our son? I understood that what she meant was, due to my being molested as a child, did I have any urges to molest our son? A painful question to hear, but one of the easiest I've ever had to answer. No, absolutely not. He is the reason I finally spoke the truth about what happened to me and have begun this healing journey. My relationship with him is one of the few things I have clarity on. This speaks to Amanda's strength and clarity as a human and as a mother. This was a hard question for her to ask me, but she knew in her heart that she had to and didn't hesitate.
Having the same lawyers, Safechuck and Robson both shared a very similar trigger that after all these years eventually made them allegedly realise that they had been sexually abused by Michael Jackson. Similarly to the Spielberg prophecy in Wade Robson's complaint, an underlying theme in Safechuck's complaint is his bitterness about his failed career ambitions. In his complaint, he vents his frustration and blames Michael Jackson about the fact that his career and professional life did not turn out the way he imagined as a teenager. We also learned that he aspired a career in show business. Initially, he wanted to be an actor, but he says Jackson talked him out of it. Then Safechuck aspired to be a movie director. He had big dreams for himself about making it in the movie industry. Safechuck also tried to make it in the music industry. He had a band. However, his show business dreams never materialized, and in 2003, at the age of 25, he finally gave up and moved on to have a normal life. He remarks that for a long time, he believed that Michael Jackson was sincere about our getting together to make movies or do something together in the entertainment realm. He had always said that I would do great things with him, and I never doubted him. Safechuck eventually went to community college and became a web developer, but in his complaint, he blames Michael Jackson that he did not manage to get a better education. He claims that Jackson talked to Safechuck's parents out of sending him to college and to focus on filmmaking instead. Vince Finaldi, lawyer of both Robson and Safechuck, repeatedly supplied tabloids with material that they could use to generate bad press for the estate and thus Michael Jackson. Channel 4 is set to broadcast the documentary Leaving Neverland in the UK. Doesn't even try to hide how the film is aimed to ruin Jackson's reputation and impact the estate's business. Robson's lawyers, who also recruited a female accuser whose lawsuit was announced around Halloween 2016, when the media interest in Thriller by Michael Jackson is especially high. A few months later, the woman dismissed her own lawsuit and vanished. The sole purpose of the accusation seemed to be about making Michael Jackson look bad in the press. A similar media assassination attempt was made back in 2013. In early 2013, AEG was hit with a lawsuit by Katherine Jackson and Michael Jackson's kids for the wrongful death of the late King of Pop. AEG warned us that something ugly was going to come out in this lawsuit. On March 21st, the judge allowed the child abuse allegations to be raised in the trial for AEG to make a case against Jackson, alleging Jackson was responsible for his own death. This is the same day Wade Robson put his house up for sale for $789,000, which sold on May 8th for a whopping $825,000, $36,000 more than he asked, only a day after his allegations went public on May 7th, 2013.
So Wade Robson now says, very contrary to what he said in the stand, he now says Michael Jackson molested him when he was a child. Your reaction?
It's absurd. It's ridiculous. It flies in the face of his very powerful testimony for the defense in Michael Jackson's criminal trial. You know, he was the first witness I called in the defense case. And if you put on a defense case in a criminal trial, you always want to start with a powerful witness. He was very powerful for us. He said that nothing untoward had ever happened. He said there had been no sexual molestation, no inadvertent touching, nothing improper by Michael Jackson. And then he withstood a very powerful cross-examination by a very seasoned prosecutor, and Wade Robson never changed his position. He was adamant that nothing had happened. In fact, he called the allegations ridiculous. I don't buy it for one second. I don't know who's influencing him one way or the other. I don't know why he's been induced to apparently change his very strong and very powerful testimony of 2005. And remember, he didn't just give testimony in the courtroom. He did some interviews after the trial where he also said it's ridiculous, nothing happened. He would look at the people interviewing him and ask them if they'd ever slept in a bed with a friend or with a parent. I mean, he could not have been stronger for us. And I don't know who's influenced him. I don't know whether he needs money. I find it very curious that this development happened in the middle of the civil trial that Katherine Jackson and Michael's children have filed against AEG. None of it adds up very well to me. AEG's lawyer got up in his opening statement in that courtroom and said things were going to get ugly, suggesting he's going to try and vilify and take Michael Jackson's reputation and try and pound it and hurt it. And, you know, they're trying to minimize the value of Michael Jackson's reputation.
You sound like you think AEG has had communications with Wade Robeson even before the case started.
I've said what I'm going to say about that issue.
These tactics appear to be directed to pressure the Michael Jackson estate to settle and or prejudice the jury in case there is a trial where damage could be demanded. Manley and Finaldi, Robson's and Safechuck's lawyers, have already been involved in previous cases of victim phishing, according to an article published by themediareport.com in 2012. During the An Open Secret movie controversy, Manley and Finaldi were also the lawyers for the accuser Michael Egan and admitted to the two formerly accused Garth Ancia and David Newman that the allegations against them were untrue. In connection with the signed admissions, lawyers Jeff Herman of Florida and Mark Gallagher of Hawaii paid what Ancia's representatives described as a seven-figure settlement to the two men. Let's also remember that in his 2016 deposition, Wade Robson's brother Shane stated that during his breakdowns, Wade was worried about his ability to support his family and had financial concerns. Wade's mother also admitted in her deposition that regarding Wade's finances, there was a concern. It is important to stress that after Robson's lawsuit was dismissed, the estate is now demanding compensation for legal fees for over $100,000. During the Q&A after the screening of Leaving Neverland at Sundance, both men claimed they were not offered any money to participate in the documentary.
I think a lot of people might have a question like, you know, were you what's in it for you to tell the story now? And, you know, were you ever offered any like compensation by the production to participate, or, you know, what are you gaining from this personally other than just getting the story out there for people to know?
Yeah, from the get-go, there was no money, ever offered or expected anything. So this was really just trying to tell the story, shine light on it, and the same way, knowing that Wade went through it, we could give other people that same connection and comfort that we've gone through something like this. That's
yeah, I think that's what I and what we have been looking for, and that was the goal of deciding to try the case route, was not just looking for a platform to be able to tell the truth.
Yet very recently, Robson set up a fund asking people to contribute towards the healing from and prevention of child abuse. Interestingly enough, the fund was set up just before the release of the documentary and about 6 years after the allegations became public. Also, according to journalist Roger Freeman, Robson will avoid filing out tax form 990. In summary, both Robson and Safechuck are failed movie directors with delusions of grandeur, represented by the same shady lawyer. Both men only realised that they had suffered abuse from Michael Jackson when they imagined their sons being molested. Both men had financial motives. Neither of the two have a single shred of proof to back up their allegations. It's up to you, the viewer, to decide which is more credible. That Michael Jackson abused these men from childhood and they both had the exact same unusual realization process as adult men, or that these two men were not abused by Michael Jackson, but in fact they saw an opportunity to financially exploit a deceased man via his companies to the tune of over $1 billion, a man who is not able to defend himself against such serious allegations. I suspect you already know the answer.
If I am guilty of anything, it is of believing what God said about children. Suffer little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. In no way do I think that I am God, but I do try to be God-like in my heart. I am totally innocent of any wrongdoing.
napiszcie na wrotki, potrzebują.
Co?
Napiszcie na wrotki. Nie
This video is to show people that I believe these two are liars. And if you believe two people to be liars, and I believe this video shows them lying, if you believe that they are liars, then it throws into question everything else they say. Because when can you trust a liar? Do you then say, oh, I believe they lied about this, but this bit's true? So what is the lie? What is this big lie? Now, even if they were sexually abused, there's a thing called a statute of limitations. And it's only 3 years from when you become an adult in California. I think they're pushing it out to 10 now, but it's 3 years. And if that time limit's up, well, it's one of those too bad, so sad scenarios. You cannot go and seek justice against this person. But there is a big loophole. And that loophole is, if you never knew it to be abuse, if you couldn't understand it as abuse, or if you went to therapy and it was discovered that this happened to you, the clock restarts. It's like you hit that reset button, and now all of a sudden, this big roadblock is removed. You can sue. And guess what? They're suing. They're suing for $1 billion. But to do that, they have to keep up with this lie that they didn't understand that they were sexually abused having oral and anal sex with this man. So we're going to watch these videos, these clips of the Oprah interview, and you're going to see firsthand how they keep up with this lie and why they have to lie for their lawsuit, which is still pending, their $1 billion lawsuit, to proceed. Watch these two lie over and over again.
No, that it was abuse.
Yeah, at that point, you know, when the abuse started, and when I was 11, even when I was 22, and later, I had no understanding that what Michael did to me sexually was abuse.
He had no understanding that what happened to him was abuse. No understanding. even as an adult, even in his 20s when he testified, even when Michael died, no understanding. Come on, man. This is really hard to believe. It's very easy to get your head around the idea of what is sexual abuse. It is you, as a child, having sex with an adult. And you may have struggled to understand your emotions and all these things, but it's not a question of whether you understand your emotions. It's a cut and dry thing. Did this happen to you? Swear under oath. Did this happen or did this not happen to you? They understood it. They understood it clearly. But they're not saying, hey, we understood it to be abuse and we decided that we're going to protect Michael. Because guess what? No lawsuit. If they said, yeah, we knew we were having sex with Michael and he was child abuse, but we wanted to protect him because we love him. Well, there is no lawsuit for that. The statute of limitations has expired. It has to be that you do not understand it. So that's what he's saying. Let's look at the next clip.
Adult men. Right. But when did you start to think of it as abuse?
It wasn't until Wade came out. I was really suffering. I couldn't sleep at night. I would sleep for 2 hours and I'd wake up and my body was buzzing and I'd be up all night. And I hated myself. And I don't know why. It's like, why do I hate myself? And this intense feeling of hate is, it's, you don't understand it. And then when I see Wade come out, you go, okay, maybe there's a reason for this. And if there's a reason for this, now I can figure out what to do about it. So but you don't think it's abuse.
So he says if there's a reason for this, maybe he can do something about it. Well, the truth be told, he was already contacted by Wade's legal team. They'd contacted him. They were trying to get to go after Jordan Chandler. He apparently fled the country. He didn't want anything to be involved with this case. So I find it really dishonest that he's saying, oh, I saw it on TV and you know, I couldn't sleep and maybe I should do something about this. Well, that's not how things went down. You're just lying. Why didn't you say, hey, I was contacted by the legal team and I started to think about it? But he can't say that. Remember, it has to all come out under therapy. He wants to hit that reset button on the statute of limitations.
What to do about it. So you don't think it's abuse.
So when Wade came out and we saw him on the Today Show, was that the first time you consciously recognized there were others? Because obviously you recognized there were others because you testified in a trial.
Recognize there were others. I testified when I was a little kid.
A little kid. See, that's diminishing language. Like, I didn't understand it. I believe he was 15 years old at the time. You're going to understand that when you're 15, if you're having sex with a man at age 10, that's called sexual abuse. If you'd performed oral sex on a man, that is sexual abuse. And he uses this diminishing term. I was a little kid.
And you don't think about there being others. Your brain doesn't go there. You're just thinking about you and him.
How could he not understand that the most publicized story of 1993 involving Jordan Chandler and the scandal and all of that, how could he not think of other victims? It was every day in the news. So again, I'm seeing somebody being dishonest and trying to diminish their role and come up with this excuse like, oh, I didn't understand it, you know?
And so, you know, when Wade came out, I was triggered by it.
Triggered is such an interesting word, isn't it?
Had tried to get a job working with his organization or going on tour. Why would you want to continue? Can you explain to people why you want to continue the association if you have been abused?
I had no understanding of it being abuse. You know, I loved Michael.
That reaction, oh, I had no understanding. So the question was, why did you try to work for Michael Jackson's Cirque du Soleil after he died? And he says that even in his 30s, he didn't understand it and he loved Michael. This is really pushing believability at this stage. It really is. It's like shocking. It's like you are blatantly lying and repeating this lie, and it all goes back to the lawsuit. You have to lie.
Many, many times that I gushed over him publicly in interviews or whatever it may be, that was from a real place, mm-hmm. you know? While never forgetting any of the sexual details that happened between us, but having no understanding that it was abuse, having no concept in my mind that anything about Michael could ever be bad. Anything that Michael did was right to me.
How could he say that there was no concept that it was bad? I mean, come on, man. You were an adult. You swore under oath. You were drilled. You kept saying no. I mean, of course, every smart person in this world would know that even if you want to hide it, it's abuse.
For so many years.
So even when you're on the witness stand and you were up there for hours and it is grueling.
Yeah.
To be on trial for anything. Even when you're on the witness stand defending him, you still did not think he was doing anything bad, or were you defending him because of your love for him? That's what I'm trying to understand. Did you think he might have done a bad thing, but I'm going to defend him, or did you not think it was bad? That's what I'm trying to understand.
Yeah.
I mean, look at that reaction of him thinking. It's like, how do I spin this? I got to say something. Like, I lied under oath. If it happened, I lied under oath. Or nothing happened and I defended my friend, but he's really looking for something to wing it. And listen to how he wings it.
I didn't think about it as far as that concept. I know this now, that I couldn't even go there. I couldn't even question Michael. Because if I was to question Michael and my story with Michael, my life with Michael, mm-hmm. it would mean that I would have to question everything in my life. So it wasn't even an option to think about it.
Mm-hmm.
Michael was good. That was all that existed in my mind. Michael
and you,
never...
And in your mind, you were there to protect him and
yeah,
to
and
save
was,
him.
Yeah, that was a huge part of it. Yeah. You know, he started that.
So there you go. It's like he wings it. He's trying to find something to say. And he's like, I had no concept. And, you know, this is a liar. You're listening to somebody caught out. Oprah just caught him out. Like, what were you thinking? And he had to come up with something. And this is what he came up with. And the reaction on his face when he's thinking, you're like, it's a liar.
You know, as it said in the film, I started seeing in my head
images,
it happening
images.
To my son. And that was the first moment that I ever, ever thought in my life, maybe I need to tell someone about this.
So this is another invention of the lawsuit, that when he had his son, he started to wonder if he was going to abuse him and whether there was going to be sexual, and it drove him crazy. And, you know, it's really sickening. If that's actually happened, but come on, man, this is a lawsuit and you need a reason. You need like a reason why this started, and you say it was a breakdown, and then you say, well, it's my son. And how about it was $1 billion you wanted?
Therapy before.
Yeah.
But you were also lying to the therapist.
Yeah.
How does that work?
Yeah.
You were lying to the therapist because you were determined that you're going to protect.
Right. And
there's Oprah Winfrey, and she's putting pieces together, and she just doesn't get it. It's like you were having therapy, and none of this came out. So why'd it come out later? And she uses the word lying, and it's the only word to describe what he's doing, because this interview's like, it's almost like a school principal or a teacher when they catch kids and they're doing something and they're trying to get to the bottom of it, and you watch kids squirm because they're lying. You know, if you've ever been, remember back to childhood, and you're pulled up with somebody else for doing something, and you watch your friends lie or you lie and you try to get away with it. This is exactly the same sensation I'm getting. I'm just watching somebody spin it.
Yes, but when you filed the lawsuit in, what, 2014?
2013.
Yeah. You were looking for financial...
Well, what it's about was I was trying to figure out... A desire started arising in me through once I was, I don't know, maybe about 9 months or so into my healing process mm-hmm. after disclosing. Well, the question was, what could I do something good with this bad? You know, with this horrible thing that happened to me, what could I do that could maybe turn it into something good? Is there a way, is there a platform, is there a place where I can tell this story that would be a credible, powerful platform yeah. to tell it within?
So he leaves out that he tried to have a book deal. He tried to sell a book with salacious tales of sexual abuse and a whole bunch of other things. The reason why the book was never published, because no publisher wanted it. They didn't want to touch it. Okay? And then comes the lawsuit. Let's continue.
You know, where they would have to listen. Right?
They who?
They, the estate.
The estate,
yeah.
Okay.
That they would have to be held accountable. Mm-hmm. You know, I could have, I guess, just gone on some TV shows and done some interviews, and more than likely it would have been sensationalized and over in a couple of weeks. So for me, that's where it began, is what, you know,
but
that's
you...
one of the platforms we have is the legal system.
Okay.
This is where we bring this
so
sort of
So did you
stuff.
Think that you were owed money, that you should have some money?
It wasn't a thought of mine. It isn't a thought of mine.
Can you believe that? It wasn't a thought of his. He's suing for $1 billion. They listed a whole bunch of things why he needed money. He couldn't work anymore. He was traumatized by Michael. He couldn't direct anymore because Michael Jackson had this prophecy it'd be bigger than Spielberg, which caused a mental breakdown. And then he couldn't work because the industry was so in love with Michael, he would be blacklisted and all these other things. And guess what? When his lawsuits failed, he went back to work. So he was very much after money as compensation because he wasn't working. But oh, wasn't about the money.
It seems like you're further along in the disentanglement. You are, Wade. Yes?
Maybe so.
Is it because you had more therapy? You thought about it more? What?
I mean, you know, everybody's journey is completely individual. And everybody's timing is completely different. That's something I've really learned through this process.
Okay, that's the last clip. And I wanted to show that because he can't say that he's healed. He can't say it's better because the lawsuit is still pending. If you say everything's better now and I'm pretty much healed... Well, guess what? Your damages go down. So he can't say that, and James can't say that. And look at the shrug. When he does that little shrug, when she asks, you know, that's him saying, oh, gee, I don't want to blow my lawsuit right here. So all in all, this to me, these video responses, this live interview, I'm so glad it's live and not edited. It shows two people who are lying. Regardless of whether any sexual abuse took place, they're lying. Either it didn't take place and it's all made up, or B, it did take place and they're like, you know what, I'm gonna lie through my teeth to get around this statute of limitations and I'm going for the $1 billion. So that means they're liars. If they're lying about not understanding it to be abuse, what else are they lying about? Are they lying about what did take place? Did something take place and they sensationalized it and said, well, there was porn, there was oral sex, there was sodomy. If you sensationalize it and you're going and your game plan is for an out-of-court settlement, well, that's what you're going to do. You hope that the Michael Jackson estate reads the claim and says, wow, this can never see the light of day. I know you're after $1 billion, but will you take $50 million each? And they're going to say, yeah, maybe that was the game plan, okay? And you got to sensationalize it because that's your goal. This is pretty much an extortion case in my books, okay? This is extortion. They're after the money. They're playing the game. And just look at the body language. Look at their minds spinning as they try to diminish their responsibility as adults to report child sex abuse. And so it's a responsibility as well. If you're being abused or were abused, and now this guy's still sleeping with the kids, you have a moral and legal obligation to support the police. The police come to you and say, did this happen? We want to put this guy away to save other kids. You better get on board. Okay, so I really dislike how these two are being presented as some sort of heroes for coming forward. They're either lying 100% or they're lying about aspects of it to line their pockets with money and fortune and riches. Don't be fooled, people. Like this video, share it, let people know. This video shows two liars, and this is a con.
Have you seen my childhood? I'm searching for the world that I come from. 'Cause I've been looking around and lost and found.